Well, I'll make this very brief. As you all know, Professor Mori won the Fields Medal in 1990, and even more importantly, he was the founding, one of the founders of a new, very important field in algebraic geometry, the minimal model program, which used to be called the Mori program, in honor of Mori. So I will stop here and pass it to Professor Mori. Shigefumi, can you hear me now?
Yes, yeah, thank you. Thank you for the nice introduction. So let me, go to the screen. So I'm honored to give a, to give a talk at the Kuranishi Memorial Conference. I was a visiting professor of Math Department, Columbia University, for 2 years, from September 1985 till June 1987. This was initiated by Professor Kuranishi's invitation, possibly in spring 1985. He was chairman of the math department then. Of course, this did not happen out of the blue. I had correspondences earlier with Henry Pinkham at Columbia University on several topics related to research and administration. I had a very favorable impression of him and the department. So I and my family, I mean, my wife and two boys, indeed, had a very pleasant and fruitful stay during those 2 years. Masatake was known for his perseverance in his research among his colleagues and students. So I do respect his style of research, and I want to be so myself, though it's not easy. Okay. This is a copy from Google. Those days, we were worried about the security of New York City, but everything needed was found nearby, and we could make a very compact and comfortable life. For instance, math department was here, and our flat was here on West 112th Street, close to the cathedral. Cathedral Church of St. John and Divine. We often went to the hospital, Mount Sinai, Morningside, for a couple of incidents, especially because we had two kids. They went to a nursery around here. And Masatake and Sayuri often invited us to dinner at their flat. They were so kind. We enjoyed their great hospitality and delicious food, as well as a nice view of Hudson River. Below, I would like to explain how the project of MMP came around and how it was before my visit to Columbia, and how they stay, how the stay at Columbia helped later developments. So to explain the birational geometry, I usually start by putting a metric on an algebraic variety. And one can quantify how X is curved at the point P say, in the direction of a plane, R2 in the tangent plane, a tangent space of x at p. So either positive, negative, or zero. And these three have different geometries, as is well known. Geometers try to treat them separately. Incidentally, my talk is not very technical, so not intended for experts. So in case of algebraic curves with dimension one, let's see. So curve C will look like, by counting the genus, the number of handles. So G is from zero to one and to bigger than one. And depending on the genus, these are how C is curved at each point. Of course, this is done in the earlier, in the second half of the 19th century. And the case of algebraic surface, blowing up a point of a surface starting from here, it goes S prime, where P is replaced by a P1 called minus one curve. It's a rational curve called minus one curve. And starting from S prime above, one can blow down the curve C to P. This is called the blow down and also contraction. And Enrique's quadratic classification intends to generalize the classification of curves to dimension two up to blowing ups. So this was based on the minimal model program in dimension two around 1900 by the Italian algebraic geometers. And let's briefly review the traditional MMP. So if a projective surface X has a minus one curve, one can contract it by X to X prime and work on X prime. And one can work on X prime until we find no minus one curves. Then X is either a P1 bundle of a curve like this or P2. These correspond to genus zero or minimal model. So this corresponds to genus zero, one or larger. This was done by combination of arguments based on a case division. And the arguments are very technical for, if the surface has symmetry, like a G-action, sort of G-action, then the arguments became very technical. And myself had difficulty in following it. Let's see. Now, again, putting metric. We want to consider the case, this positive case. To be specific, what if a variety is positively curved everywhere for all p and all directions? And this is actually called Frankel or Hudson conjecture. So Frankel conjecture, it was in 1961. It says, if a Kähler manifold is positively curved at every point and R2 in the tangent space, then X is isomorphic to a projective space. And then Hudson 1970, made an algebra geometric analog with the weaker hypothesis. It says, every projective manifold with ample tangent bundle is isomorphic to a projective space, Pn. The first one was solved by Yao and Xu, and the second by myself. These are all around 1980. And there are various positively curvedness. So the lower, the weaker the condition. So sectional curvature positive for all P. This is a condition, the Frankel conjecture. And the tangent boundary is ample. This is Hartzsprung, the condition in the Hartzsprung conjecture. So this is weaker. Weaker condition is that anti-canonical divisor minus K is ample, since minus K is a determinant bundle of Tx. The intersection number of minus K with C for a curve C in X is positive. Of course, if K minus K is ample, the intersection with any curve is positive. So we will come back to the last later. So the question now is, what if we have some kind of positivity measured by this intersection number? So it is more likely the second and third case happen. So Hartzsprung conjecture via P1. So I proved the Hartzsprung conjecture as a corollary to a weaker version of the following. If a projective manifold is positively curved along a curve, then X contains a rational curve. So this was proved by only by characteristic P argument. And it used Frobenius morphism, pth power. And as far as I know, it's there is still no characteristic zero proof. So I'd like to have one. Anyway. Outcome of the rational curve is the following. So after I produced the rational curve, I thought I didn't use its power to its full extent, and I wanted to look for what it can. And in the search, I stumbled over the notion of extremal rays, which led to the study of minimal to the extremal rays, which led to the study of a more general problem. So it's to find the key structure of a variety positively curved along some curve C. So Kleiman's cone of curves says that in second homology of X with real coefficients, consider the cone spanned by curves, spanned by the classes of curves on X. It's a closed cone, a closed convex cone. And so it's an invariant of X. And X, this is how it looks. So this is origin, and it comes out from the origin and spanned by the classes of curves. And K, since it's K is a divisor, it lives on the space of curves as a functional, linear functional. And K equals zero is a hyperplane, and K negative or positive half spaces. But anyway, that's And the excimer array is the following. So the cone I explained here is on the half space K negative. It's sort of polyhedral or finitely regenerated away from K equals zero or K positive. And this is a picture of the cone by L equals one with L hyperplane. And each ridge line, these green ones, each ridge line on K negative is called an excimer array. So what is the geometric meaning of an excimer array? So this was the main theme. And this excimer array is generated by a rational curve obtained by the earlier method to prove, which I used to prove Frankel or Hudson conjecture. So looking at the surface case with this ray, there are three cases, P2 or P1 bundle or a minus one curve. So in the first case, the whole cone is generated by one vector. Oops. And in the second case, the cone, the ray is generated by the class of a fiber. In the third, there is a minus one curve which generates the excimer array R, and C is contracted to a smooth point. And curve C is sent to a point below if and only if its class belongs to R. So this is the contraction morphism of R, and it is the geometric meaning of R. So just a minute. So let us look at the two-dimensional MMP again. So if a projective surface X has an excimer array of birational type, that's the third one, then we pass to its contraction X prime and work on X prime. And we repeat until there is no R of birational type. Then X is either P1 bundle of a curve or P2 or minimal model. So this simplifies the two-dimensional MMP. And even this G surface case as well. And the definition is that X is a minimal model if KX is nef. That means K dot C is non-negative for all irreducible curve C. And it does not involve minimality in terms of dominance. So we go to the dimension a smooth threefold case, dimension three and smooth. So in this case, funnel fibering, I'll define funnel in the next slide. It's either the contraction of the excimer rays to a point or to a curve or to a surface. Or divisorial contraction. It contracts a divisor. So either a divisor is contracted to a curve or to a point. And the target space can have a non-Gorenstein singularity like C3 modulo involution. So this was the minimal model program was initiated. But here, by the contraction, we introduced a non-Gorenstein singularity. So here comes terminal singularities by Miles Reed. So if one runs MMP or just a contraction from a smooth n-fold, in this case, n is actually 3. One can get a P2 that is mapped to a singular point, C3 modulo involution by a contraction. And so if we create a theory of cones allowing such a singularity, then one may get a worse singularity. And if we create another theory allowing the worse singularity, we may get a worse one. So there may be no end. Here comes Miles Reed. His terminal singularity, he introduced it in 1983, has a property that if X has at worst terminal singularities, then so do those produced by divisorial contractions from X. So this is hopefully a stable class of singularities. So the cone of theory of cones and theory of terminal singularities really started the minimal model program. And I wanted to understand these terminal singularities. So he, in his paper introducing terminal singularities, he gave a description of them as hyperquotients, quotients of some kind of hypersurface singularities. And based on that, in 1983 or 4, I managed to classify three-dimensional terminal singularities. So it was around this time that I had correspondences with Pinkham at Columbia University. And it was about this classification, and I very much appreciated this correspondence. Anyway, I wanted to classify them because I needed them to study flipping contractions. So later, Miles Reed, in his Young Person's Guide to Canonical Singularities, cleaned up the messy classification of terminal singularities of dimension 3 that I made. And using this terminal singularity, a more general framework was constructed. Kamata, Reed, Shokurov, Benveniste, and others constructed the general framework. This was around 1983 or 4. So it's still the same cone of curves. But the hyperplane K, that used to be K equals zero, is now KX plus D equals zero. So XD, the pair XD is allowed to have slightly worse singularities, a Kamata log terminal singularities. And we perturb the hyperplane K equals zero with the D to KX plus D equals zero. So with this new, more general framework, the contraction of extreme array on three dimension looks as follows. Final fibering and divisorial contraction. So it contracts a divisor. This is a case of contracting a divisor. And the target space has a good singularity, terminal singularity. But there is a third case, the flipping contraction. In this case, no divisors are contracted. Still, the target has bad singularity. And in the target, the canonical divisor is not even Q Cartier. No multiprobit is Cartier. And this can occur for non-Gorenstein X, when X is not Gorenstein. Before going further, let me step back to the smooth case. So I want to mention a little bit. A smooth variety is called Fano if anti-canonical divisor is ample. Iskovsky classified the Picard number one case in his two papers, 1977 and 78. And Fujita had related work using delta genus. This was published in 1979. And so these, it's important that these were Picard number one case, mainly Picard number one case. And myself and Mukai classified smooth Fano threefold with Picard number one as an application of extreme arrays. Actually, this was 81 was before my flip paper was published. My extreme array paper was published. And so I moved to Nagoya in July 1980. Where Mukai was, and this was how the joint work started. And it was based on my announcement in PNAS 1980. Curious point is that when the Picard number is bigger than one, it used to look more difficult, but with extreme arrays, it's actually easier because we have at least as many as row extreme arrays, and each extreme array gives good information. So this way we could manage the classification. Actually, the great part of was done by Mukai. I wanted to find only the primitive ones, but he managed them all, and so that's how it happened. Now back to the flip. So to continue the minimal model program, we want a flip or something to handle the flipping contraction. So in contracting extreme arrays, we face a case where X is contracted to Y, and no device is contracted. And Y, the contraction Y had a bad singularity. And we were stuck there. Then here comes operation flip. So, oops. Remove a subvariety here. So in plane dimension three, this means we remove a curve from X and put back another curve to X called X prime. And there, canonical divisor is ample. So somehow the sign of K becomes opposite. Unfortunately, at that time, existence of such a flip was unknown. And I think it was around 1983. I cannot remember exactly fine. It could be as early as 82 or as late as 85. But it was announced by Tsunoda, Shokurov, and Kamata. And they were later published in various ways. Now, my approaches are more sort of primitive. So I wanted to compute what happened. So it started when I was at Princeton. So I was at Princeton at the Institute in 1981 to 82 in the algebraic geometry year. So I kept the computations. So this was a hand computation by hands I did around in 1981. Now, even I have a difficulty understanding what I did exactly, but starting from the extrema, from the flipping contraction of in a semi-stable degeneration of a surface, I blow up, I make a certain specific blow up and do some specific birational transformation and get something and compute the result. But then I became slightly more sophisticated. I use a calculator to compute these numbers. It looks complicated, but they came out of these computations. So this was when I came back to Japan from the Institute. I bought a calculator. And I computed the first computation was done within an hour or so. The second and third, several hours. But then it takes longer and longer. So I couldn't continue. I became desperate and I bought a computer. And I started writing a basic program. I mean, I had no experience of computer. So at that time, NEC started selling something called the PC9801 and with a big 8-inch floppy disk drive. And I learned basic, very basic. But to my surprise, the basic at that time did not behave very logically. I cannot remember exactly what the trouble was, but it was like a line of commands like while XX do YY. Now, even if X is false, the program performs YY at least once. This was something I never expected. Because of this, I got the wrong answer. So I had to start over. Anyway, in a month or so, I could do the computation as many as I want. And those are the pictures. And starting from the picture above, I got the flip. And this is the picture of how I make the transformation. Anyway, I computed the semi-stable flips in many examples. So one of the main construction was published much later in 2002, since I did not need them. Now in 1984 to 85, Miyoko and myself published the result on uniruledness. This was a very important result for the to use a minimal model program. Actually, it came out of Miyoka's lecture at Nagoya University. He had everything there, and I noticed that proves uniruledness. I only said that. That's how it came out. Of course, I'm so happy. In 1985, I got the invitation of Kranich to Colombia. I think it was at a certain point, I think he gave an international call to me. I was, of course, surprised. And though I had dreams to visit the US and do more computation and research, it's actually quite difficult to actually do it. But then the phone call urged me to. Then the visit was made possible by colleagues at Nagoya University, Matsumura, Professor Matsumura and Kitaoka. Professor Matsumura kindly took over my course on commutative algebra. And Kitaoka took over my grant. Since I was in the middle and I didn't know what to do. And then in July of that year, there was an AMA summer school at Bordeaux. I gave a series of lectures. It was then Lee's Young Person's Guide on Terminal Singularity came around. And we arrived at Colombia at the end of August, 1985. So this was a very busy summer. In 1985 to 87, this was my stay at Columbia. So in 1985, I continued computations on flipped curves. So I even brought my computer PC9800, even with 8-inch floppy disk drives. Then next year, 1986, it was algebraic geometry year at Columbia. We had various visitors. So for instance, Miyoko visited Columbia. This was actually the base of our later joint work, Kolar, Miyoko and myself, on rational curves on algebraic varieties, which were done in 1990s. Then Clemens invited me to stop over by University of Utah on the way back to Japan. So Fitch initiated my several visits to Utah. And it resulted in a fruitful collaboration at Salt Lake City. So all these came out of this algebraic geometry year. So now my work on the existence of three-dimensional flips. This was motivated by Kamata's work on semi-stable flips that I mentioned earlier in my earlier slide. I got the preprint and I got motivated. And also I got inspired during conversation with Kolar Janos. So he was at Princeton and he was often visited. So this happened in the summer of 1986. And that summer, we rented a summer house in Vermont. And we had a very nice summer. I mean, my family had a very nice summer. We had a very nice view. But I again brought my computer and I started writing the proof. But still, it was a very nice summer. And after I wrote the proof, I kept it about half year, just seeing if anything is wrong. And finally, I submitted it in 87 and published in 1988. In the fall 1986, I gave a course on Iskovsky's work on smooth final threefold with Picon number one. This was again a complicated story. So I lectured on Iskovsky's double projection for final threefolds, such that Picard group is generated by Kx. And then the error was fixed by Iskovsky himself and using the MMP and Kolar's flips published in 19, I forgot the exact, but my idea. It still used the existence of lines by Shokurov. Katkowski published another argument. It's sort of explicitly computing the flop without a flop. And then the double projection of final threefolds was refined by my student Kyohiko Takeuchi in 1989 using MMP and flops. This time without using the existence of lines by Shokurov. It was so, in this sense, it was really refined. Then Mukai gave a totally different biregular classification using vector bundle methods. So all these happened during the very short period of time. Now, coming back to the flip. So flip was like flip was expected to exist, and I managed to flip. Managed to prove the existence in dimension three in 1988. So later, Heikkinen and Makanen proved it for all dimensions along, this was in 2007, and this along Shokurov's philosophy. now in MMP in dimension 3 or larger. So repeat dimension, divisorial contraction and flips, it terminates, we get a minimal model or a funnel fibering, just like a surface case. And termination in dimension 3 was proved earlier by Shokurov by a very nice argument using difficulty. Then a particular kind of MMP, MMP with scaling, was proved to terminate in most cases in all dimensions. This was by Birka, Cassini, Hacon, McCannon, a so-called BCHM. And canonical ring RX is always finitely generated. And more general versions are proved in the relative and log versions. But anyway, that's something more technical. So going back, in dimension 2, we contract minus one curve and repeat it till there is no minus one curve. Then we had either P2 or P1 bundle or minimal model. In dimension 3, it was done by myself, Reed, Kamata, Benveniste, Shokurov, Miyaoka, Kolar, and others. And it has three new ingredients: extreme array and flip and singularities. Now it works in all dimensions in most cases by BCHM. And MMP has become a fundamental tool to study algebraic varieties. Our stay at Columbia University resulted in a three-dimensional minimal model program and further developments, only some of which I could mention here. I'm so thankful to Masataki and Sayuri for the splendid 2 years at Columbia University. Thank you very much for your patience. Sorry, I cannot hear you.
Sorry about that. So thank you very much, Professor Mori, for this wonderful history that I lived through at the time and watched you progress. And you, of course, didn't get into your history to your main contribution.
You helped me a lot.
And so thank you again. And does anybody have any questions here? Nobody? Going once, going twice, going three times. I guess there are no questions. So thanks again.
Thank you.